Okay, my name is Marcel Beemster from Solid Sense. We have a product, a test suite for C, C++. Unfortunately, that's not an open source product, which in this environment is not a good thing. But in order to apologize for that, I'm going to hopefully teach you a little bit about thinking about safety and safety critical applications where software and compilers are used. Around the year 2000, there was a main brand of cars that were developing a problem. The problem was in unintended acceleration, so the car would suddenly speed up, and the driver would have a very difficult time stopping the car. And actually, over the course of about 10 years, at least 35 people were killed due to unintended acceleration, and some estimates go as high as 90 people. Now, over the course of the 10 years, there were a lot of investigations into this as well, obviously, but no root cause was found. The floor mats were changed, all kinds of things were changed to the system, but it was very persistent. And as part of the investigation, also the software was looked at. Now, to say it mildly, the software exhibited a lot of code smells. And just to mention two, one of the critical functions, the one that computes the angle of the throttle, it had the size of 1,300 lines. And that's, quite a lot. And it's not a good thing. Another thing is use of global variables. Who here in the room would think this would be a doable task with less than 100 global variables to write this software? Nobody thinks they can do it with less than, who thinks it should be done with less than 100? At least one, okay, I see some figures, okay. 100 global variables is a lot, and actually it should have been done probably with no global variables at all. But in fact, the number of global variables in the throttle control system was in the order of 10,000 global variables in a piece of code to compute the throttle. So that's not good. So we're going to look a little bit deeper into what a compiler means, safety of a compiler in cars in particular. It holds for other safety critical applications as well. As you see here, the compiler plays a very crucial role. It sits in the middle of this software for the brakes, and then it's compiled the code, and the code is loaded into the car, and it sits there, and it has to work right, and it should do a good thing there. Now, to the best of my knowledge, most of the compilers used in the car industry today are GCC compilers and proprietary compilers, not particularly LLVM compilers. But that is changing rapidly because the car industry fell in love with C++. So there are changes there. So in order to say something about safety and compilers, that leads to questions. So we get to some questions here. What is safety? What does it mean? Can we talk about a safe compiler? What does it mean for a compiler to be safe? And how, what is the relation between safety and quality? Now, to start with the relation between safety and quality, we've got this example here. We see these two cars have collided as a result of a driver error in the driver of the blue car swerved to the wrong lane and hit the bus. It was a bad accident, but the driver of the blue car survived. That's a good thing. But you can also see that the blue car itself did not survive the accident. The blue car itself is destroyed. It will never go on the road anymore. On the other hand, the bus, it probably has some scratches, but it will drive away from the accident. So in terms of quality, we could say, the yellow car has a much better quality than the blue car, because the blue car is destroyed, right? But on the other hand, the driver of the blue car survived, the driver of the bus as well, by the way, and the people in the bus too, so no real harm was done, ultimately. But if the blue car had been made as strong as the bus, then the collision would have been so much more forceful and so much more impactful that probably the blue driver would have suffered more permanent damage than what he did now. So this is to say that quality, in this case, the quality, the strength of the car, is not the same as the safety of the car. The safety of the car is improved by making it weak in the front so that it crumbles when it hits something. So a little bit of demo about safety and quality here. I've got here a little bit of code. Cursor too. Okay, I've got a little bit of not so innocent C++ code, and I'm going to pass it to the most up-to-date Clang compiler here on this fully up-to-date Ubuntu system. So I'm going to compile it now, and we see here that we have a core dump. So we have here an LLVM core dump, Clang core dump. Now, in terms of quality, you might think, oh, oops, that's not a very good thing. This is not a good quality compiler. It core dumps on a random piece of code. How can this be good? But if we think about this in terms of safety, there's no issue with safety. It's much better that the compiler core dumps and produces no code at all than that the compiler would produce some code that's incorrect and is loaded into the car. So in terms of quality, yeah, you don't like to see core dumps. In terms of safety, that's much preferable than generating incorrect code. So we see that here. In terms of quality of the car, we can have opposing forces here. We can have a very strong car that's not good for safety. So we would choose a less quality car, a car that brakes easier, in order to improve safety. Now, I don't think we have the same tension in compiler development. At best, a core dump, a bad quality, is orthogonal to safety. But in general, we can state, I think safely state, that good software engineering is also good for safety. It's not sufficient. You may have to do additional things for safety, but at least it's a good step in the right direction. So that's lesson one. Quality and safety, they're not the same things, but in terms of software engineering, they usually go together well. Then the next question is what is safety? What is this thing safety? And here I have a definition that comes out of the ISO 26262 standard for automotive safety of electrical systems. And here's a definition of what is called functional safety. So we have this additional word functional. And the reason is that we have that there is that we want to talk about the function of a car maybe or a component in the car. And we want to say, okay, we want to define if this component malfunctions, then there is a safety issue. In the case of that crash over there, there was no functional safety issue. There was a safety issue because obviously there was a crash, but there was no functional safety issue because the cause of the crash was the driver making an error. The driver went to the wrong side of the road, but the car itself, up to the moment of the collision, was functioning perfectly. So functional safety has to do with components or assembly of components making mistakes and going bad and making errors. Okay, here we have the definition, the absence of unreasonable risk due to hazards caused by malfunctioning behavior. Malfunctioning behavior is pieces breaking down, so we've covered that. Unreasonable risk, that's partly a judgment call. There's no fine definition what is risk, and it may even differ in different perceptions of risk and unreasonable. What does that mean? So there's room for discussion in that definition as well. And then there's hazards, and hazards in this context means a source of harm to a person. And that's also a crucial aspect of functional safety. We are talking about potential harm to people. One of you, me, people outside. That's also an essential thing. This is out of safety instructions from a microwave oven. Here, never attempt to dry a pet in the oven. This is not a safety warning, because a pet is not a human, it's not a person, and therefore it doesn't fall under the definition of functional safety. In the functional safety world, we can safely ignore pets. Another case, here we have this moose that potentially crosses the lane. Becomes difficult now because maybe your car has something like collision avoidance software. It would recognize the moose and then it has to make a decision. How do I protect the passengers of the car? And well, maybe if it's too late to swerve away from the moose and protect the passengers at the same time, maybe it's better to hit the moose in the right way so that as few as possible the passengers are not hurt too much. But if the collision avoidance system has some kind of malfunction and recognizes the moose not as a moose but as maybe two people with an umbrella, then it would have to make a different decision there. So that leads to a whole different decision, because then then there are people there, and those people have to be the system would have to try to avoid hurting those people as well. So that's lesson two. Functional safety is concerned with people getting hurt by malfunctioning of equipment. That's what functional safety is about. Well, where does this all start? Thinking about safety started more than 150 years ago. This was a locomotive engine somewhere in the UK in 1853, which blew up. And that's in the middle of the Industrial Revolution. Governments started to worry about the safety of the people. And then thinking about safety started. In particular, it started here in this area, in the German area here, this area where there was a lot of industrial activity. And we can trace the existence of many safety institutes here in Germany, all of the TÜV institutes, back to that development that started here in Germany more than 150 years ago. Now, interesting, we have now safety standards tracing the roots back 150 years ago. We don't have similar things for security. And that's why security and safety, in terms of the industry, they're treated very differently. We don't have good standards and not a long history in standards for security yet. Well, for safety, they're quite well developed. So here we see sort of taxonomy of safety standards for electric, electronic, and programmable systems. So the mother standard is the top standard. And then we have derived standards, which are similar to it, but are specialized to areas, automotive, rail, nuclear, aviation industry. And there are more, like for the medical industry, that's also a safety critical industry. So there are also other standards. We're going to look in particular at this standard that I'm most familiar with, the ISO 26262 standard, because that's the one that currently in this industry has a lot of attention and requires a lot of work to be done. So, yeah, what's in those safety standards? They're organized according to such a model. You see here the V model. The V model of engineering is very central to the safety industry, the safety thinking and these standards. The V model, the safety standard, it describes the functional safety life cycle. It starts on the left with really the concept phase. It ends over there on the right with the decommission of a component. And you can think of something like an airbag, that has to be decommissioned in a safe way. you can't just hack an airbag out of a car because it might explode, there are explosives in there. So that's important. We see this sort of in the middle right thing with a small V in the middle of it. Section 6 is concerned with software development. So that's about the application software. And we have here this point 8-11, that is confidence in the use of software tools. And that is where compilers fit. That is where the functional safety of compilers is discussed. So the V model, a bit more explanation. It is all about, on the one hand, on the left side, there are the engineering activities, the actual creation of your engineering artifact, requirements, design, and then implementation at the end. In some models, you find time here as well, so suggesting that we would start on that side and finish on that side, but that's really a misnomer because basically the V model has to be in place all the time during the development of systems. On the right side, we see the proof for the things that were stated on the left side. So we see the unit testing as proof of our implementation. We see integration as proof of the more high-level design of software, component, hardware, could be anything. And validation, finally, as proof of the requirements. Now, that loop has to be put in place during an engineering job, and it has to stay closed at all the time. The top two on the left side are usually paper documents, or at least the documents. In a computer nowadays, of course, not on paper, but they're documents. And here we really have, in the implementation, we really have something machine interpretable, the implementation. And then on the right side, we get to the proof of the system. And there we can make the proof fully automated. We can build tests for all of these levels, and all of these levels can be automatically tested, and we can put that into place so that during the software hardware development cycle, these tests are always executed and always running correctly. Now, that fits very well with iterative software development. Here we usually have, most of you, I assume, work with iterative software development. You have in a sprint, you have a design phase, you have a phase where you think about things, where you may have to change existing decisions in the design of the product. You have an implementation phase, you have a testing phase embedded in that. And so part of the sprint is involved in making sure that the loop is closed again. If you change something to the design, you have to be able to find the integration tests that belong to that design change and modify them as well. That is all part and should all be part of the of one sprint in an iterative design model. So that's lesson three. Iterative development, modern software engineering styles, they fit quite well with the V model of engineering. Next, this is what ISO 262, the standard for road safety, tries to ensure. It tries to ensure that the components are used within the bounds of their specification. So, there are a couple of words that it sounds okay, but there are a couple of things here. Ensuring, how does it do that? By actually requiring documentation. It requires you to document. And also, what needs to be documented is how the tests match to the specification. That's an important part of the traceability of the system, of the V model. And furthermore, there's this quite innocent word used, which looks okay, but if you think about it, that can be quite complicated. I brought here with me a prop. Here, I got here this piece of wire. You can just buy it in the shop. And the question is, how safe is this piece of wire? Now, I can do terrible things with this piece of wire. I can stick it in my eye and then my eye would get hurt. I could try to strangle myself with this piece of wire. So all bad things can be done with this wire. So this can be a very dangerous piece of wire. So it's hard to talk about, is this a safe piece of wire? So in order to determine that, we have to think about how is this piece of wire used and who is responsible for how that piece of wire is used. So that's lesson four, basically, in functional safety. The use case, how something is used, is essential in the determination of functional safety. And that is ultimately decided by the user of a particular tool or component or software or whatever. So when we think about compilers, you as compiler developers are not the ones that define the ultimate use case of the compiler. That is the compiler end user. So in a way, it is not you that is responsible for the safety of this compiler, because you cannot state this compiler is safe or not. You can only state it is safe when I use it in this particular way. And that's a very important thing as well. So diving a little bit deeper, we've seen that compilers were covered by this single line in the ISO 262 standard. And that line says confidence in the use of software tools. So compiler is a software tool, and that section mentions how we should look at this compiler and use it safely. On the other hand, part six was dealing with application code. So there's quite a bigger section. You have to do actually more work for the functional safety of the application code than you would have to do for the compiler. And libraries are not mentioned at all in the standard, and that's a bit of an omission, I think. And so the consensus nowadays is that basically libraries should be treated like application code. So the more strong measures have to be taken to do the safety qualification of the library code. So what do you need to do for compiler qualification? First of all, you need to define your use case. How are you going to use this compiler? So that is in the hand of the user of the compiler. It's not your job as a developer of the compiler. That is in the hands of the user of the compiler. User doesn't like that because he would just like to push a button and get his code out of it, but he really has to think about how the compiler is used. Next step is then that there must be an assessment of the risk. If this compiler is used for the software of the brakes, that's a high risk thing. If it is used for the software of the entertainment system, that is a lower risk thing. The standards do allow more and less risk. So there are various levels of risk. And if there's a high level of risk, then we should validate the compiler by a verification process. And the verification process requires that the compiler is then verified against the language standard. So that's basically this level here. We need to have the definition of the compiler, and basically that is defined by the language standard. The language standard says, okay, the code that is generated should behave in this particular way. That's the guideline, also your guideline as developers, to make the compiler work. And that has to be matched by a test suite that is organized according to the language standard. You work mostly with the test suite that comes with LLVM. That test suite is not organized according to the language standard. You cannot look up a paragraph in the language standard and then find the associated tests in the LLVM test suite. It's simply not organized in that way. You really need a different organization of your test suite that shows, okay, for this paragraph there are these tests, and this test is here because it matches that particular paragraph. That's a requirement of the standard, And that's where our test suite fits in. If you look at software development, application and library development, there are some additional things to be done. First of all, you have to do, again, the definition of your use case of the software. Your risk assessment has to be done. You have to do your proofs according to the fee model. So you have to do your unit testing. You have to do your integration testing. You have to do the more high-level testing. But additionally, you have to have in place suitable guidelines. And for the car industry, these guidelines are the MISRA-C programming guidelines. And the MISRA-C programming guidelines are not easy to follow. They're very strict and very picky. If you put a perfectly nice, ordinary, well-tested, nice piece of software through the MISRA checker, it will generate many, many, many violations of the MISRA standard and require lots of little things to be changed. So it's not easy to follow the MISRA guidelines. That's basically what I tried to say here. It's not easy to do that. And another requirement is that you require your unit testing has to show 100% code coverage and also branch coverage. And the MCDC is a particular kind of branch coverage, but it really requires that you do your coverage testing and show 100% coverage of both branches and statements in your code due to the unit testing. That again is a very strong requirement on code. So yeah, these are additional things required for, this is a very high level overview. There are much more details about all of this, of course, but this is the very high level overview. So that's the end. Your take home messages. First of all, quality and safety. Quality of software engineering and safety, they're not the same, but they do go together quite well. In functional safety, the concept of the use case is essential. This piece of wire is not safe by itself, or not safe or not safe. It depends on how you use that piece of wire. Compiler qualification is not rocket science, especially not for us developers, because it's simply going through a test suite and checking that things go well. But for end users of the compilers who are not used to examine their compiler and who would like to trust their thing, it's often a more complicated process. And finally, not all test suites are created equal. You have different levels of testing, and these different levels may require different test suites. So thank you. Questions? Yes.
Has to be qualified against the English standard. Is it only just an example which rest of the standard? Are there any other good examples of compiler verification, like target code generated or something else? I mean, automotive standard.
Are you asking about the test suites or
the
test methods?
I'm asking about what has to be validated according to the automotive functional safety standard in the compiler.
Well, you have to validate the compiler, so you have to check that the compiler works well. And in order to do that, you have to verify the compiler against the language standard. And for that, you need a test suite that covers the language standard.
Yes,
and there are more test suites. Supertest is one, but there's also Perennial. Plumhole is not complete enough, by the best of my knowledge. But that is basically it. There are not many more options that you have.
But all the pieces you mentioned related to the language,
No. Okay. Yeah, no, it is certainly true that the test suites themselves go deeper than just the language. But what you have to verify is the language implementation. Yes, that's what the standard requires. It doesn't require you to specifically look at the code generator, for example, because the language standard, which is the definition of the compiler, doesn't say anything about the code generator. It just tells you something about the behavior of the code, and that behavior needs to be checked. And it doesn't need to go into the optimizations.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Thank you for your talk. One question I have. So actually, I have two questions about LLVM. So the first of them is optimizations. I heard that it's actually really going to say optimizations are either not allowed or only extremely limited subset of them should be used, because the key concern there is source code traceability. And as you do some optimizations, you basically lose the exact correspondence to requirements. That's my first question. And the second question is that you did not actually mention a status of LLVM adoption in safety critical industry. Like, I know that, for example, some very old data compilers are certified, or some GCC compilers are certified, but it would be interesting to learn, for example, if like some LLVM version, like 3.4, or maybe something, is actually certified in your industry. Thanks.
Okay, well, first about the optimizations. In the aircraft industry, where the rules are more strict, they do more often adopt this rule that you should not use optimizations, because you want to have the traceability between the source code and the target. But if you have qualified the compiler running with the optimization that you are going to use for the production code, then actually optimizations are allowed. If you can show that the compiler behaves well with the use of these optimizations, then it's okay to use optimizations in the car industry, in the ISO 26262 standard, at least. Second question, remind me.
The second question was about
adoption of LLVM. Yeah, okay. I know there are LLVM compilers. Not completely open source, but I know front ends and LLVM optimization parts compilers with proprietary code generators that have been qualified according to ISO 26262 and also the other standard, the top level standard. So they have been qualified, they do exist, but I must again say they are qualified for a particular use case, for a particular combination of options, etc. I have no idea where there would be an overview of that. No, that's not common knowledge within the industry at all. So that information is not shared. The car industry in particular is very competitive, and that doesn't mean that they like to share a lot of information.
Their tools are actually intended to be used from, I believe, very unusual angle from what developers usually see the LLVM developer.
Right.
So especially, it's a lot of research projects and people just do some stuff. It gets into developing trunk, but basically most of the people, they don't think through the whole, from this perspective, from this development.
Yeah, that's true. I have no answer for you about that, because the what has to happen in order for a compiler to be used in a safety critical area is that someone qualifies that compiler. So it could be the case that maybe a component, a car manufacturer would take an open source compiler and qualifies that compiler according to the standard. They might even find bugs in that compiler, but they might not even want that those bugs to be fixed. They might just want to live with the bugs and document, okay, this compiler, we know it very well, it has these and these and these errors, we don't want to touch it anymore because it is qualified now in the way that we have it here, and we want to use it for the next 10 years. So you will not get much feedback from that. And that is, in one sense, of course, it is it is a bit of a problem, because that feedback is also essential to improve the safety and the quality of the compiler. Now, more often it will be the case that there will be a company in between that packages the compiler, maybe with a proprietary code generator, but maybe maybe just by itself, completely open source. When they will do the qualification process, they might find things, they want them fixed, they will feed that back to the community, and you will hear from them in that way.
One more question.
I'm okay.
This would have been a follow-up to the previous question.
Yeah.
It's really a follow-up to your second question, I think. Because you talked about like certified compilers, and I know there are some like research groups and there's a certain community that usually does relatively formal work on thinking about how you certify a compiler.
Right.
Semantics, which is not a language, which is a simple task, and then you have to make sure formally that you have a way of generating code from that which actually behaves according to the semantics. And you have, in response to that question, occasionally used the term certified as well, but really you're talking about qualification, you talk about qualified compilers.
Yeah.
And to me these things seem to be like different things. Right?
Yeah, I have never used the word certified, and that was very much on purpose. Certified is a very strong wording, and it requires that someone ultimately puts a stamp on the compiler and says, I guarantee that this is behaving according to this certificate. And that is not required by the safety standard, because that's a much too strong requirement. No, it has been done for open source. I know in one specific case where it was done for a compiler to be used in the railway industry. They took 3 years with a team of 10 people to go through the compiler source code. Every line was annotated, every line was looked at. And after 3 years, they had a very thick stack of documentation and they certified this compiler. After these three years, the chip that actually was the target processor for this compiler went out of commission. And so at that point, they had to buy the complete stock of all the chips in order to serve that industry, that railway project for the next 30 years, because trains have a long lifetime. So it's a very impractical thing to certify compilers. This document, ISO 262, is created by the car industry itself. So they have made sure it is practical enough. If it is good enough, I'm not sure about that, but it is practical enough to be used by the car industry.
One last question. Are you going to file a bug report?
Good news. It is fixed already in newer versions of LLVM.
Okay, thank you. Let's speak again.